العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. اللهم اجعل أعمالنا خالصة لوجهك ولا تجعل فيها حظا لغيرك، وصل اللهم على سيدنا ونبينا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. الحمد لله رب العالمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. How's everyone today? Alhamdulillah. We continue with Surah Al-Kahf bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. We ended on verse number 31. We read number 31. I'll just read a couple of verses. We continue. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات إنا لا نضيع أجر من أحسن عملا أولئك لهم جنات عدن تجري من تحتهم الأنهار يحلون فيها من أساور من ذهب ويلبسون ثيابا خضرا من سندس واستبرق متكئين فيها على الأرائك نعم الثواب وحسنت مرتفقا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was describing the people of Jannah. After describing the people of the hellfire, Allah mentioned the abundance of favors that they will have and the variety and quality of those favors. Right? Adornments of bracelets of gold and clothing of silk, of variety of textures and etc. Reclining on like royal beds, if you want. What an excellent reward that is, and what an excellent resting place. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes into the next story of the surah, as I mentioned before. Right? We said the surah is made up of four stories. Each of those four stories signifying a test. Right? Four stories, each of those four stories signifying a fitna, a test. The purpose of it is to highlight for ourselves, or to highlight, to understand those tests, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also gives us the solution to that test. Right? So we had in the Ashabul Kahf a test in relation to deen, in relation to religion, worldview, way of life. And the solution to that was to have steadfastness, but through company as well, through pious and good company. But now we move on to the second test, and the test that is symbolized or highlighted in this story is a test of wealth, right? The test of wealth. First was a test in relation to deen, yeah, it's a test in relation to wealth. Now, the beauty of this test in relation to wealth is that it neither, and in fact the beauty of all of this is that I call them fitna. Now the word fitna in our mind usually has a very, very bad connotation, right? Because we sometimes use the word fitna to refer to gossiping, which is actually ghiba or buhtan. That's the actual word for gossip. But fitna linguistically just means a test. It doesn't necessarily mean something good or something bad. It doesn't necessarily mean something good or something bad. It's bad if you fail. And it's good if you pass. Allah says elsewhere in the Quran, أَلِفْ لَا مِمْ أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Do people think that they will be left to say that they believe without being tested? Right? No. Rather, we will be tested, and that will distinguish the righteous from the sinful, etc. So, when I use the word fitna, I'm not necessarily saying, as I said, it's a fitna of wealth. I'm not saying wealth is a bad thing. That's not the understanding that we convey. No. In fact, we'll see the very story itself shows us that the understanding that Allah is conveying is not necessarily that wealth is intrinsically bad or it's a bad thing. No, but it's our attitude towards it. It's attitudes towards these things that decide whether they are good or bad, which we'll come to see now. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, واضرب لهم مثلا. واضرب, what does that mean? ضرب يضرب, we learned this and said it like thousands of times probably last year. What does it mean? To hit, right? But when it's used with the word, when the maf'ul of the word is mathalan, then it means to set an example or to forward as an example. And sometimes you translate it as strike an example of something. So what's the maf'ul over here? Idrib, and then there's a lahum jaru majrur, and the maf'ul is mathalan. So what's it going to mean here? Set an example for them. Give them as an example. Forward as an example. Or if you want, strike an example. The word is idrib. Which form of the verb is that? It's an amr, right? Daraba yadribu, darban, daribun, duriba yudrabu. ضربا مضاء أو مضروب, and then the أمر will be اضرب, and the نهي will be لا تضرب. This is the command here. Singular plural, is it saying many people strike something or one? One. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to the second person singular in the Quran, then what is it usually refer to? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, set an example for them, strike an example for them. Strike for them, mathalan, an example. What is this example? The example is rajulaini. Rajulaini means two men. Two men. Ja'alna li ahadihima jannatayn. Ja'alna, we have made لِأَحَدِهِمَا. The fa'il of ja'ala is who? Ja'alna, we have made. And then we have a jar or majrur there, right? لِأَحَدِهِمَا. Ahad means what? One. Ahad and hima, huma, them two. So أَحَدِهِمَا, one of the two of them. So we made for one of the two of them. What did we make for them? What's the maf'ul? Jannatayni. We made for one of them two gardens. Jannatayni. We made him two gardens. Min a'nabin. From? A'nab is the plural of a'nab. A'nab means grape. So he had grape vines. Wahafafnahuma binakhlin. What does haffa mean? To surround something. So, وَحَفَفْنَا, who's the fa'il? Again, na. And we surrounded them. What did we surround? وَحَفَفْنَا هُمَا. The two of them referring to two gardens. Referring to two gardens. وَحَفَفْنَا هُمَا بِنَخْلٍ. With? Nakhl? With dates, with date palms. So he had vineyards and he had date palms. In fact, Allah is creating a beautiful picture of the person's wealth. He had vineyards surrounded by date palms. وَحَفَفْنَاهُمَا بِنَخْلٍ وَجَعَلْنَا بَيْنَهُمَا زَرْعًا. وَجَعَلْنَا, and we made بَيْنَهُمَا, between the two of them, between, meaning between these two gardens, زَرْعًا. زَرْعَ refers to crops. And so we Allah is saying basically, ja'ala means to make or place. So we placed between these two gardens a variety of crops. So I mean, just if you try and imagine that, you're thinking, you know, vineyards are not usually small. So large tract of vineyard on one side, some crops in the middle, large vineyards on the other side, and all around the rest of them you have vineyards, date palms. It's a lot of wealth. I don't know if I mentioned it here before, but yeah, it's a lot of wealth. A palm tree costs a lot of money. Palm tree. How much does a palm tree cost? I think I checked it somewhere not too long ago. It was like either 20,000 rand or something like that. For one. بعد ميتة سبحان الله. I checked the price with some Tamils. I was reading a hadith and then that person, the Sahabi, gave like 600 date palms. So I thought, nah, that's a lot of money. But anyways, وَحَفَفْنَا هُمَا بِنَخْلٍ وَجَعَلْنَا بَيْنَهُمَا زَرْعًا. Then Allah says, كِلْتَ الْجَنَّتَيْنِ كِلْتَ الْجَنَّتَيْنِ. كِلْتَ means what? You know, you have the word كُلُّ. كُلٌّ, right? When you want to use a dual form of that word, but a feminine dual form, then you'd say كِلْتَ. كِلَا would be the masculine. كِلْتَ would be the feminine. Both of them, basically. So each of them. The masculine would be كِلَا. The feminine form would be كِلْتَ. Meaning كُلُّ وَاحِدَةٍ مِّنْهُمَا. Each of the two of them. Each of the two of what? كِلْتَ الْجَنَّتَيْنِ. Each of the two gardens. آتَتْ أُكُلَهَا. آتَ يُؤْتِي means what? No. آتَ means to come. آتَ, oh sorry, آتَ means to come. آتَ, when it's used with the harf bi, it means to bring. But on the fourth bab, this one is on the fourth bab. آتَ يُؤْتِي means to give. I think every single class since I started teaching, maybe 9 years ago, 9 or maybe even 10 years ago, every class mixes this up. Ata, come. Ata plus B, bring. Ata, give. Now this is the fourth bab. Ata, to give. Atat. What does that mean? Give, but the feminine form, isn't it? And why are we using feminine form here? Because it refers to a jannah, a garden. Jannatun is a feminine word. So each one of the two of them, atat, gave, ukulaha. Ukul means what? We know the word akala. Akala means to eat. So ukulaha will mean like its produce, the things that you eat. Basically, it would give fresh fruits, because that's what you're going to be eating from there. آتَتْ أُكُلَهَا وَلَمْ تَظْلِمْ مِنْهُ شَيْئًا. وَلَمْ تَظْلِمْ. ظَلَمَ يَظْلِمُ means to what? To harm, to oppress, to be unjust. Right? To wrong something. But who is the fa'il of it here? تَظْلِمْ. ظَلَمَ يَظْلِمُ. تَظْلِمُ. And then we have a lam before. What does lam do to a verb? Lam. It's a lam, yeah, right. So what does that mean? Instead of having a dhamma in it, now it has a sukoon, right. What else does it do? It's a present tense form, but it has a past tense meaning, right. But who's the fa'il of تَظْلِمُ? يَظْلِمُ, تَظْلِمُ. Who's the file? How do you look for a file? Eli? Right, so look. Is there anything on the end? No. Is there anything on the left? Minu, shaya? No. So where do you look next? Inside, what's inside there? Two possibilities, right? Just say it's from clear. Yadhlimu. يظلمون تظلم تظلم هي, right? And then يظلمنا, and then again تظلم. So it could be you, or it could be yes, her. Oh, but we know also in Arabic all words have a gender, so it could also mean just it, right? It. And in this context we are talking about an it. What's the it? The garden. There's no you. We're not speaking about we didn't mention a you anywhere. Yeah? We're speaking about the garden. So here it's it. The garden did not oppress. Or here the word dhulm actually means to decrease. It did not decrease minhu from it, meaning from its ukul.
The who there refers to أكل. It did not decrease from its produce or its fruits, شيء and anything. Meaning it gave like a full crop, a bumper crop every year. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave this person such wealth. Vineyards surrounded by date palms with crops between them. And it's not just that they were beautiful in terms of how it looked. That's why Allah created the image of the visual image of the garden. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, in addition to that visual, beautiful visual image of the garden, these gardens, they produced. And they produced a bumper crop every year. They did not decrease from their crop in any way. It's almost as if Allah, you don't say, my farm decreased its crop. The farm doesn't do it. The farm's inanimate thing. But it's as if, you know, it's as if Allah's personifying the garden. It's as if Allah's personifying the garden, saying, this garden is like in your service. It's giving you the fruits. And it is not wronging you in any way. It's giving you a full measure. And it's just, that's the beauty of the example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given. وَلَمْ تَظْلِمْ مِنْهُ شَيْئًا. And then Allah says, وَفَجَّرْنَا خِلَالَهُمَا نَهَرًا. فَجَّرَ means what? To cause something to gush. So Allah says, وَفَجَّرْنَا. We caused to gush بَيْنَهُمَا, between these gardens, نَهَرًا. نَهَرًا means a river. نَهَرًا. وَكَانَ لَهُ ثَمَرٌ. وَكَانَ لَهُ ثَمَرٌ. كَانَ means was. وَكَانَ and there was. لَهُ for him. For who now? Not the high anymore, not the Jannah. The Jannah was being referred to as how all the time. Now we're referring to who? Who is him? The owner. Right. وَكَانَ لَهُ and there was for him. If you want to say, I have something in Arabic, how do you say? You can say عندي شيء, or you can also say لي or لي شيء. So if I say له بيت, what does it mean? How are you going to translate it? له, literally you're going to say for him is a house. But it's essentially what you're saying is he has a house. So how are you going to translate this now? وكان له ثمر. For him was fruits. How are you going to translate it? And he had fruits. Samar refers to fruits. وَكَانَ لَهُ ثَمَرٌ. And he had fruits. فَقَالَ لِصَاحِبِهِ. So he said لِصَاحِبِهِ to his صاحبة means to accompany someone. He said to his friend, to his companion, وَهُوَ يُحَاوِرُهُ. وَهُوَ, how are you going to translate that? Wow. Yes, that's correct. I want to know, how many wows do you know? You know wow that can come at the beginning of a sentence. You know wa that means and. You know wa that means by. Yeah, you also know wa that means that's when it means by. Wow حالية. When I say wow followed by al-damir, then it means whilst he was doing something. So he said to his friend, whilst he was doing what? Wahua, whilst he yuhawiruhu. The verb is hawara yuhawiru. Which verb? Fa'ala yufa'ilu. Third verb. Right? Hawara yuhawiru. What does it mean? You can, third verb has a idea of mutuality, right? Mutuality. More than one person engaging in the action. Hawara yuhawiru means to dispute, engage, speak to, but more in a with a idea of arguing or disputing or something like that. وَهُوَ يُحَاوِرُهُ. He said to his companion whilst he was disputing with him. What did he say? أَنَا. This is now the beginning of the sentence. This is what he said. أَنَا. I am أَكْثَرُ مِنْكَ. أَكْثَرُ means what? كَثِير means a lot. أَكْثَرُ mean more. So I am أَكْثَرُ more. Minka. When I have this form of the word akthar or af'al, then the min will mean what? Then. I am more minka than you. But what does it mean I'm more than you? There must be something qualifying what you're speaking about. I am more than you malan in wealth. In wealth. وَأَعَزُّ أَعَزُّ. It's the same form. It should be أَعْزَزُ. But it comes from عز, which means might or honor. Right? This is وَأَنَا أَعَزُّ. And I am more honorable. نَفَرًا in نَفَرًا means like in groups or in people. Meaning I have more children than you, and I have more people serving me than you. So what's he doing here?
Boasting.
He's boasting. He tells his friend, Allah has given him all the stuff. Now if you look at those verses, you'll see Allah the fa'in. That's why I asked you the fa'in. All of the time Allah says what? Allah says what? وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الرَّجُلَيْنِ جَعَلْنَا لِأَحَدِهِمَا جَنَّتَيْنِ مِنْ أَعْنَابٍ وَحَفَفْنَاهُمَا بِنَخْلٍ وَجَعَلْنَا بَيْنَهُمَا زَرْعًا كِلْتَ الْجَنَّتَيْنِ آتَتْ أُكُلَهَا وَلَمْ تَظْلِمْ مِنْهُ شَيْئًا وَفَجَّرْنَا خِلَالَهُمَا نَهْرًا. Allah is attributing all of the wealth that has been given as gift from Allah. But then what does he say to the other person? He becomes arrogant and he says, أنا أكثر منك مالا. I have more wealth than you. وَأَعَزُّ نَفَرًا مِنِي. And I am more honorable than you in terms of people that I have, children and servants, etc. So we look at, so we can understand what the test is now. Wealth entering the heart and leading to arrogance and kibar, essentially. Yes. So we'll see what the solution is in the next part of the story next week, inshallah. We're in there for now. Wa jazakumullahu khairan wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.